Hello, and welcome to the Black Ponder. I'm Neil Trotter. Today, we're going to be talking about Islamic philosophy. And we're going to do that via this text right here called On the Harmony of Religions and Philosophy by the great Islamic philosopher Ibn Rushd. Now, this text right here covers several different topics, but the topic I'm going to focus on this video that this text covers is the topic of free will. So, people get into a lot of debates about free will. Do people actually have free will? Does free will really exist? And then people have these debates and they're not really sure of the actual definition of free will, or they're not even in agreement with what they're talking about when they discuss free will. Are you talking about this ultimate absolute version of free will where people can decide every aspect of their life or the world or the universe and their influence in it? There's this stance, of course, that there is no such thing as free will and free will doesn't exist. And there's the religious spiritual version of that, and then there's like the scientific secular version of that, right? The secular scientific version of that is, well, basically everything is determined at the subatomic level, the quantum mechanical level, and things happen as a result of probabilities, and you know where subatomic particles are in their relation with each other and their location and the probable potential of these relations and locations and the workings of these subatomic particles, and that's how everything is determined, and we have no control over that. That's just nature doing its thing, right? So there's that position, and then there's like the religious position of, well, there's this supreme almighty being who controls everything, and if you were to say like you control something that you can decide on your own, then you're implying that you have control of things that are outside the supreme divine being, the God, and you're limiting the power of God, and therefore that can't be. So there is no free will. So there's various discussion on that level. Most philosophers talk about free will. When they talk about free will, they're not talking about this ultimate absolute version of free will. They're talking about free will in a very limited scope. And many philosophers believe that there is free will at this very limited level. And despite how limited that level is, they acknowledge that there's many things outside the control of the person, the being, the human condition. Things happen that we just have no control over, but there are certain things that we do have control over, although the scope is very small. It's very small, right? But that's still very important. That's still very important. That's something that needs to be talked about, analyzed, and addressed. And Ibn Rushd is one of those philosophers who goes into detail about that. Yeah, there's free will. It's very limited, but we do have it, and it's important to talk about. And it's important to know what it is, and it does have an influence and an impact in society. So we're going to talk about his position on that, and I think it's a very important position, a position that can disclose a lot of knowledge about life, and we can gain a lot of wisdom from it. And whether you're Islamic or not, whether you're a Muslim or not, a lot of what's being said here you can apply to your life. So I will read you some quotes from the book. Again, if you're following along, if you happen to have this, this is Dodo Press version. I believe Dodo Press is owned by Amazon, I think. So just in case you have this edition, I'm going to give you some page numbers, because I get the messages like, please provide the page number, so we're gonna give you that. And it is page 23 at the bottom, last paragraph. It is evident that God has created in us power by which we can perform deeds which are contradictory in their nature. But as this cannot be complete except by the cause which God has furnished for us from outside and the removal of difficulties from them, the deeds done are only completed by the conjunction of both these things at the same time. This being so, the deeds attributed to use are done by our intention and by the fitness of the causes which are called the predestination of God. which he has furnished for us from outside. They neither complete the works which we intend nor hinder them, but certainly become the cause of our intending them, one of the two things. For intention is produced in us by our imagination, or for the verification of a thing, which in itself is not in our power, but comes into being by causes outside us. So what's being said here? Basically, what Ibn Rushd is saying is that, God is ultimately in control, right? But God grants us the ability of intention. We can intend to do certain things. So intention is what free will is. Not the physical action itself, is the intention behind the physical action, because the action itself is already predetermined by God. But your intention behind that action, that's what free will is. I continue on page 24, the second paragraph. Our own intentions can neither be compelled nor ever found on the whole, but by their fitness. So what does that mean? That means even our intentions are predetermined. So it's important to understand that, you know, this Ibn Rushd is a Muslim. He believes in the Islamic faith. So, you know, he believes God is almighty, all powerful. He's setting everything up, right? So your intentions are not compelled on your own will, but they are compelled by the fitness. So what does that mean? Well, let me read you my little note on the side here that I wrote in the margins to try to understand what's going on. Intentions, which are free will, must be healthy to be constructive. Therefore, free will is dependent on spiritual health. Spiritual health, right? What's that all about? Well, let's continue with this quote. We're still on the second paragraph of page 24. This is necessary because our deeds are only the effects of causes lying outside us, and all the effects which result from limited and pre-arranged causes are themselves limited and are found in a given quantity only. So again, it's this reiteration that since actions are outside free will is only expressed by intention. And that's my little note that I wrote there. So we're reiterating that it's all about intention, which is a very like Kantian position, Immanuel Kant type of a position. Although, you know, Ibn Rushd wrote this way before Kant set up his whole notion of free will. So the idea of intention as the most important aspect of expression is nothing new, but we need to get more deep into what it is about intention that actualizes free will. Since what Ibn Rushd is saying is that intentions can neither be compelled nor ever found on the whole, right? So if that's the case, then why are we even talking about intention? Well, we'll continue with some more quotes. This is page 26, first paragraph. The existent things from our volition are compelled by two things, our intention and the other causes. But when the deeds are referred to only by one of these agencies, doubts will arise. How about some notes for some supplementary commentary? Free will can only be understood via the spiritual reconciliation of intent and action. So, it's kind of a conundrum, if you will. It is sort of a paradox. We can't even control our intentions and our actions are outside of our determinations. What is free will? Well, you can only make sense of free will spiritually. That's the only way. And so what Ibn Rushd is saying here is that free will is the spiritual reconciliation of uncontrollable action and controllable intention. So a spiritual reconciliation of the limited control that we have and the grand uncontrol that we have. That's free will. Let us continue with more quotes on page 34. And we're starting right at the top here. These being contradictions in this problem We should try to reconcile them so that they may agree with reason. The verse, verily, God will cause to err when he pleases and will direct whom he pleases, Quran 14:4, refers to the prearranged divine will with which all things have been endowed. They have been created erring, that is prepared to go astray by their very nature, and led to it by inner and outer causes. The meaning of the verse, if we had pleased, we have given unto every soul its direction, that's Quran 35:9, is that he thought of not creating people ready to err by their nature or by the outer causes or by both, though he could have done so, but as the dispositions of men are different, the words may mislead the one and direct the other. For these are the verses which speak of misleading the people. For instance, he will thereby mislead many and will direct many thereby, but he will not mislead any thereby except the transgressors, Quran 2:24. So we're wrestling with the contradiction of God deciding everything and we having control over things. I would like to focus on that section, which I've highlighted a different color, this little part here. The dispositions of men are different. The words may mislead the one and direct the other. Okay, what does that mean? Let's refer to my notes. The variance of dispositions allows intention to be actualized among people. This is free will. The variance of disposition. So people have different dispositions, right? And those dispositions create variances in their intention. Someone who's exposed to something is going to react differently than someone else exposed to that same thing. Why? Because people have different dispositions. And that could be related to people's points of views, people's how they were raised, what they've experienced in life, their perspective on things, nurture and nature, and a lot of other things that we're not even aware of. Not everybody acts the same when exposed to the same experience. Okay, that's where you can start to begin to unravel how free will is expressed. And this is the very end of this page, this quote right here. It means that for evil natures, these verses are misleading. As for the sick bodies, even drugs are injurious. So let me read you my notes. The variance of dispositions is created by God, okay? Even that's predetermined. People are varied in their reactions based off of their various dispositions in life, but even that's predetermined. So people's intentions are founded from the variance. It is the spiritual exercise of the person which determines the intention. The spiritual exercise determines the intention. That spiritual exercise is initialized by God. So everybody is going to act differently based on their disposition, but even that's predetermined. Now, the way you impact that reaction, that intention behind the reaction,
right?
How you impact that is spiritual exercise. The intention of someone is going to vary depending on how healthy they are spiritually. And that's where evilness comes about, which is what Ibn Rushd is talking about in this last sentence here. If people react from experience without any kind of spiritual exercise, without any type of spiritual awareness, then that intention is likely going to lead to an evil intention. Let's go to another quote to further this idea, try and make sense of what's being said here. So this is page 36, and it is the second paragraph. This is all that we thought of in an exposition of the beliefs of our religion, Islam, which what remains for us is to look into things of religion in which interpretation is allowed and not allowed. And if allowed, then who are the people to take advantage of it? With this thing, we would finish our discourse. My reflections that I've written down in the margins here, what does it say? Interpretation is free will, but there is a wrong way to interpret. This is why religious study is important. This is spiritual exercise, aiming for constructive application of free will. So intention really is a kind of interpretation. That's really what it boils down to. What Ibn Rushd is saying here is that, you know, you don't really have control over the actions that you do. You don't really even have control of your intentions. The only thing you really ultimately have control over is your interpretation of these things. And in his belief system, Islam, they provide you with the Quran, and that allows you the ability to interpret your intention, the actions that come about, in a constructive way. So the way you express your free will is through spiritual practice, spiritual study, studying the Quran and understanding, okay, how this has happened to me, I feel this way, what does the Quran have to say about that? And how do I interpret what happens to me in this context, of this religious spiritual context? And that's going to influence your intention. You're going to react in a certain way. You're going to act in a good way, or you're going to act in a bad way based off of your interpretation of the situation. And your interpretation will be determined from your spirituality, your spiritual practice. In that way, free will is expressed. I continue with another quote from page 39. This is the second paragraph. In the interpretation of this also, there is a consideration about those people who know that if it is an example, it illustrates such and such a thing, but they doubt whether it is an illustration at all. If they are not learned people, the best thing to do with them is not to make any interpretation, but only to prove the fallacy of the views which they hold about its being an illustration at all. It is also possible that an interpretation may make them still distant from the truths on account of the nature of the illustration and the illustrator. For these two kinds of occasions, if an interpretation is given, they give rise to strange beliefs, far from the law, which when disclosed are denied by the common people. Now, how do I interpret what that quote is? I wrote it down in the margins, my notes. Free will is work. Effort must be made to develop free will toward constructive interpretation. So you can interpret what you read spiritually as good intention or bad intention of your own individual volition. That applies to what's happening to you as well, like the actions that you receive and the actions that you carry out. You can interpret these things, but the interpretation is not always easy to understand. And the interpretation is not always something that you can quickly deduce. You know, it takes work and it takes effort to understand what's happening to you, what's going on in life and experience. Why are these things happening? What's the meaning behind these things, these situations, these experiences? And if you're religious, what does God have to say about all that? That takes work. And it's from that work on interpretation, that understanding, that wisdom, which influences your intention. The more wisdom you have, the more constructive that intention will become. The more constructive your free will be expressed. The less wisdom you have, the less effort you put in interpretation, the less effort you put into spiritual practice, the more destructive your interpretation is, which will result in the more destructive of your intention, and therefore your action will be destructive. And this is what Ibn Rushd is talking about when he refers to good action, bad action, evil versus good. It's all about intention through spiritual interpretation. So I go to the next page, page 40, and I read you this quote. Starting at the first paragraph here. There arose differences of opinion, at last forming into sects, which ended in accusing one another with unbelief. All this is pure ignorance of the purpose of the law. From what we have already said, the amount of mischief done by interpretation must have become clear to you. We always try to acquire our purpose by knowing what should be interpreted and what not, and when interpreted, how it should be done, and whether all the difficult portions of the law and the hadith are to be explained or not. So people can interpret things in various different ways based off of how wise their interpretation is, how much work and effort they put into interpreting. So when we talk about Islam, for instance, there's very constructive ways of interpreting Islam. And you know, you see that in the Muslim world. You see that in what Ibn Rushd did and what he contributed to society, which is incredibly constructive. Look him up. He did a lot of great things for the philosophical world. But you also see bad interpretation of Islam. And you see that in radical fundamental Islam, like ISIS and terrorist groups like that. But, you know, that's just, anything can be interpreted in a constructive way or in a destructive way. I mean, it's amazing how people say how destructive Islam is, and they just completely ignore all the great things that Islam has contributed to the world and just focus on the way it's interpreted in a bad way. And that's true with Christianity too, right? Christianity has contributed huge positives to society, but it's also Christianity has been interpreted in very bad ways and has had very destructive effects. And it doesn't take much to understand that and see that in history, right? With the, you know, just one example, the KKK literally burning crosses in the name of racial hatred, right? I mean, that's fundamental radicalism right there. And we see that in the Christian world. And so then you have this whole notion of, well, that's why religion is bad. But then, you know, people who say religion is just fundamentally bad completely ignore non-religious institutions where basically the same thing happens. Right? Like capitalism, for instance, which, you know, has a lot of destructive effects in society. Even institutions or enterprises like science, for instance, have, you know, science has contributed much to in the advancement and progression of human society, but it also has had a lot of destructive effects. I'm thinking about things like eugenics, right? Any system, any institution, any enterprise, any ideology, any field of thought can be interpreted in a constructive way, and it can be interpreted in a destructive way. It depends on the person, right? And this is what Ibn Rushd is saying. It takes work for correct interpretation. And it takes work to express free will in a constructive way. You're not automatically going to express free will constructively. It just doesn't work like that. You have to really focus on improving your expression of free will. There's a lot of things that are outside our control. In fact, you could argue most things are outside one's control. The things that we experience, we have very little control over those things. But we do have control over our interpretation of those things. We do have control over that. What do these things mean? Why are these things happening? Are they completely meaningless? Or is there some sort of thing, is there some sort of core meaning I can derive from this? And what is that meaning? And once I find and discover that meaning, what am I going to do about it? How am I going to feel about it? How am I going to react to it? What am I going to do to other people? How am I going to feel about other people based on what I've experienced? That's what free will is. And, you know, religion is a way for you to discover that meaning. And it's your decision to pursue that way of interpretation or not. That's free will. But Ibn Rushd, you know, difficult to say, me being an American, you know, not familiar with the Arabic language, but, you know, great philosopher. You know, when I say great, I mean, you know, very important, had a lot, huge impact on the philosophical world and the world of ideas. And his contribution on the idea of free will is an important one. I mean, a lot of people have adopted that interpretation of free will, right? I mean, we just talked about Immanuel Kant. He's all about intention. That's what he thinks is most important. He did not originate that idea. I mean, Kant did add more to that concept. He contributed additional ideas to this notion that intention is the driving force of free will. But it did not start with him. Islamic philosophy set the stage for that. So I encourage you to check it out. Do we have free will? Yes. That's what Ibn Rushd has said. And free will is based on the harmony of religions and philosophy. That's what free will is. And if you want to know about that, check out his text. Well, you've been watching The Black Ponder. Tune in next time for more philosophical thoughts.